What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. Students and developers alike struggle when it comes to space and time complexity. So if you think that you do also, it's totally fine. Because hopefully, by the end of this video, you will have a full understanding on what complexity is and how to calculate it. To better do this, let's start with a very basic example. Let's suppose we have this array right here, filled with a bunch of random numbers, and we want to write a piece of logic to sum all the numbers inside this array. So, as we have seen in our previous videos covering for loops, what we have to do is iterate over the elements inside the array and add them to an integer initialized at the beginning of our code, right? So let's think together and try to find first the memory or space used behind this block of code. We first reserved a place in the memory for every integer in the array, that is 10 integers plus the integer named total. Do not forget this one. That will be 11 slots in total. But not all arrays in the world contain 10 elements only, so this number can vary. And if the array contained 100 integers, we would have to reserve 101 slots, 100 for the array and 1 for the integer total. If the array contained 1000 items, 1001 slots would be needed. You see the pattern? As our array grows, this 10, representing the number of integers in the array, will also grow to become n. So, if we have n integers in the array, the space complexity of our code here will be n plus 1, hence the 101, the 1001. And if we go ahead and plot the variation of the memory in respect to n, we will indeed obtain the n plus 1 function. So, s of n equals n plus 1. Now keep this result in mind, and let's move on to the time taken by our code to calculate the sum. To do this, I actually went ahead and calculated the exact time it took to sum them up. Then, I added to this list more integers, so that the number of elements in the list is 100,000, as you can see in this table. I then continued to increase the number of integers available in the array, and calculated the corresponding time taken respectively. And this can be visualized as follows. As you can see, we have a linear curve that can be written as t of n equals a times n plus b. What we did here is calculate the exact values needed in space and time by our program. However, that is not how we do things while developing an application. You see, we don't actually care what is the exact running time of our program because a lot of variables may affect that running time. For example, here, these same arrays and pieces of code, if executed by a slower computer than mine, may result in a curve similar to the purple curve, or if by a computer faster than mine, a curve similar to the green one. So, what we actually care about is the variation, how the time is increasing based on the number of inputs. You see, these three curves are different. They come out of three different laptops. But there is one common thing between the three. All of them are linear in time. What actually changed was the a and b variables in the function a times n plus b. But the linearity was preserved, and that information is what we are looking for. So, what we do, instead of writing a bunch of mathematical functions, is we estimate the need of our program by stating the highest order of these functions that we just calculated, also referred to as the worst-case estimate of the space and time that our code needs in order to execute a given block of code, also known as the big O notation. So our space complexity will be O of n, as n plus 1 has n to the power 1 as its highest order. The same applies for time complexity, which is O of n, as an to the power 1 is the highest order in this equation. Why do we do that? Because we consider that if n is to grow infinitely, which is the worst case reference, the smaller orders will be negligible before the higher order values, and then it will be enough to represent them using just the highest order, in our case n and an. Let's now take a second example, and in this one, we will try to print all the pairs of integers between 1 and 5. So the output I am actually seeking is something similar to what you can see in front of you, and it can be done by iterating over all the possible combinations of the given numbers using two nested for loops. Let's try to calculate together the space and time complexities behind this need. Concerning the space complexity, let's think about it. We don't have an array, nor do we have a variable to store a total or something. So, our space complexity in this case does not depend on the number of pairs we are trying to print, nor any kind of array. If we print 100 or 1,000 pairs, we would still allocate the same amount of memory for this block of code. And this will lead us to a big O in space complexity of O of 1. But why O of 1? Because, you see, if we try to write the space function with respect to n, and because it doesn't depend on n, it will be written as S of n times n to the power 0, which is equal to 1. Actually, any constant function can be written in the same way. And because we take the highest order of the function, as we already mentioned, and in this case our S of n does not depend on n, then the highest order is n to the power 0, which is equal to 1. Hence our big O is O of n to the power 0, which is also O of 1. Now, concerning time complexity, I also went ahead and calculated the time taken by our code to run and plotted the graph of time versus n, which can be visualized as follows. As you can see, it is a quadratic curve and can be written as t of n equals a n squared plus b n plus c. The highest order we have in our time complexity function written here is a n squared, and this could have been deduced from the nested for loops that we have. Or we can say that each item in the first for loop is being traversed n times. That makes n times n, or n squared, time complexity. And this is represented as O of n squared time complexity. So, to recap, a computer program relies on two different aspects of complexity, space and time. Space is both memory needed by the code to store information at runtime, which, if you recall our first example, is the sum or total value, as well as disk space needed by code for persistent storage, which, in our case, is the array storing integers. Time, on the other hand, is the amount of time needed to process a block of code, or in other terms, the number of operations the code must perform in order to achieve its goal. But, as we saw in our example, and since the time taken by an algorithm may vary based on several inputs such as the machine we are using, or many other variables, we tend to consider the worst case complexity, written as a function of the size of the input and expressed as the big O notation. These two complexities are the measure of how resource requirements change as the size of the problem gets longer. They both affect performance, and performance indicates how much of these resources the code employs. Efficient code uses fewer resources along both axes. The code can also be more performant if it uses more of the resources that it has plenty of rather than those it lacks in. We will encounter a lot of examples during our videos where we will need to sacrifice space in favor of time and vice versa. And that has been and will always be the case in coding. Now, if we revisit our two examples and consider that both of them are present in the same code block or method within our app, what will the worst case complexity, or big O, of our method be in this case? We discussed during this video that the first code block alone has a big O of n, and the second one a complexity of O of n squared. So the total time complexity can be denoted as O of n plus O of n squared. And we know that big O itself is a representation of the worst case complexity. Remember, the highest order in our function. So in this case, we just pick the worst of the two cases, or the highest order of the two, the one that varies with respect to time faster. And of course, it is none other than O of n squared in this case. What you see now are the most common and used functions when it comes to complexity and big O notation, ordered with respect to time. Which is faster and which is slower? As you can see, there is quite a few of them and we have only covered like three. And you may be thinking, when the hell do I have a log of n time complexity? Or a n times log of n? Well, let's take the example we previously had. And suppose that instead of printing the pair of numbers between two given integers, I only want, given an integer, to start the for loop at 1 and multiply the increment by 2 instead of just adding 1 to it. Then I will keep printing the results that I have as long as the multiplication of the increment is less than a given number. Now, given n equals 25, the code we just discussed will result in this output. We will keep on incrementing I and print it until it reaches 16. Then 16 times 2 is 32, which is greater than our n equal to 25. So our for loop ends and we have our output. Now, how do we calculate the complexity of the following code? You see, based on the output, we know that this for loop ran 5 times exactly. We can see them. We can count these numbers. So in our case, the exact time complexity, t, the number of operations we did, is equal to 5 iterations. But the challenge here is to write this with respect to n, not as a constant. Now, we know that for this for loop, our t of n is equal to a function where, if we were to replace n with 25, it will approximately be equal to 5. Well, this 5, why 5 exactly? Let's think together. Where does it come from? The number that forces us to break out of the loop. It is the 32. We just calculated it, and we obtained this number by multiplying the initial one we started from by 2 on every iteration. So what we did actually to break out of the loop and reach 32 is 1 times 2 times 2 times 2, 5 times, and that's 2 to the power 5 in this example, or 2 to the power k in the general case. So in general, we have to do k iterations to break out of this for loop given an integer n. In our case, 2 to the power 5 is equal to 32. But in the general case, 2 to the power k can approximately be equal to n. Because if our n was equal to 31 instead of 25, or even 32 in this case, our for loop would still have terminated after 5 loops and would have given us the exact same output. Because, you see, 31 is smaller than 32. So it is not entirely wrong to assume that 2 to the power k is equal to n. Now, having this formula, we can wrap both sides by log base 2. The power k can come to the side, and we know that log base 2 of 2 is equal to 1. So finally, we obtain that k is equal to log base 2 of n. We can actually verify from our example that log base 2 of 25 is approximately equal to 5. The same applies to all the numbers all the way to 31. And until we reach 32, which is exactly equal to 5, our breaking number. But now you may be asking, if k is equal to log n, then why the complexity, or the big O equals log n? Well, k is the number of iterations and operations we had to do, and big O is supposed to denote this information and reflect its variation based on the time. And that is exactly why, in this case, we have a big O of log n. Now, if we take the same for loop and wrap it with another loop going from 1 to 25, or our n, we will have two for loops, one with an O of n time complexity, and another with an O of log n time complexity, as we just demonstrated. The resulting complexity of such a code snippet will be O of log n times O of n equals O of n times log n. As simple as that. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.